Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is in Australia. Archbishop Julian Porteous invited her to speak at the Hobart Cathedral of St. Mary's on the island of Tasmania. Her talk is entitled, Same-Sex Marriage Affects Everyone. She took questions afterward, too. Those are available in the Ruth Refuge podcast.
Thank you so much, Archbishop Julius, for having me here. It's an honor for me to be here. We've heard about your troubles even back in the U.S. And so when I found out that you were interested in having me come, I was honored, you know. I'm actually on a list of official hate groups sponsored by the Southern Poverty Law Center. When I got on this hate group list, one of my friends said to me, gosh, they'll let anybody on this list. You know, you're not nearly mean enough to be on this list, you know. So we live in strange times. And my role here tonight, I think, is twofold. One is I want to help you to see the stakes that are involved in the referendum that you all have coming up soon. And so I want to send you out here fired up, basically, you know, that something has to be done so that you understand what could happen if you lose this thing, okay? And also, I want you to understand that you can win this thing, okay? You can win this, and it's important that you do, all right? And so there are a number of organizations working together, and I hope that you'll get involved, all right? Now, I'm not in charge of any of that local stuff. I don't know exactly what's going on, but I'm sure that the Office of Family Life and the Archbishop will help put you in touch with anybody that you want to. So the first thing I'd like to do is to invite you to sign up on the Ruth Institute sign-up sheet that will allow you to receive the weekly newsletter that we send out. So Nick, if you would start circulating this. This is my son Nick, by the way. who travels with me and keeps me together. You'll receive a newsletter from us once a week. If you read this religiously, you will be very well informed about what's going on because this topic is very big. And that's one of the problems that we face, is that the topic is actually very vast. And if you're trying to deal with a set of slogans, and your response is something vast, you're kind of at a disadvantage sometimes, right? But you need to be well informed because you need to understand what's going on. And also, I'll send you this PowerPoint, so you don't have to take too many notes, madly, but you can take some notes on the handout which I have given you. So I want to begin with an apology, and that is, I first of all want to apologize to you, as an American, for what my country has been inflicting on the rest of the world with respect to the sexual culture, the toxic sexual culture that exists around the world, especially the Western world. Between our pop culture that is very toxic that we export all over the world, the history of population control that the United States was involved in and to some extent still is involved in, and now this latest business of promoting LGBT rights around the globe as part of U.S. foreign policy, I feel it's necessary to apologize to all of you. I'm sorry for what my country has been doing, and I'll try to make up for it. I also would like to apologize to the young people in particular on behalf of my generation. The baby boom generation has left you guys a mess. I'm sorry, and again, I'm trying to do my part to straighten it out. And I know that there are other people of my generation who can testify similarly, you know, that a lot of us did crazy stuff and, you know, kind of lived to tell about it, and we're sorry. But it's necessary that we do so. So now we really are in a long-term struggle to defend and protect our way of life. Now, how is it that our way of life is actually at stake? Well, look, the definition of marriage, when we redefine marriage, we redefine parenthood. And this is something people don't understand, but redefining marriage redefines parenthood. And so your idea of what counts as a mom and a dad is not what these other people have in mind as what counts as a mom and a dad, all right? So it's a very, it goes to the core of our identity, the core of the relationships between generations. All of that is at stake in what we're talking about here. Even our understanding of ourselves as male and female. What does it mean to be a man? What does it mean to be a woman? Is this something that we're, are we really born that way as a man or a woman? Or is that negotiable and malleable, all right? All of that is now up in the air. And then finally, of course, the education of our children is very much at stake, and that's something I'll talk about a little bit. I know you all have issues like that already going on with the Safe Schools program that you have here. And then, of course, the overarching problem that we face is the crushing of dissent, the absolute crushing of any form of dissent, which your Archbishop has had some experience with. That was an intimidation play, basically, and that will only continue and grow worse. And so what I want to say to you is that if you have this election, which you are going to have an election, if you lose, that will be seen as a sign of weakness, and all of these things will come rolling into place. So it's very important that you win. It's not simply that redefining marriage is going to somehow cause all these other things to happen. It's the political implication of losing, all right? So it's very important that you that everybody, you know, turn to and do their part and do what you can do. So I want to begin by telling you just a few words about the Ruth Institute and why we're in business, what we're in business to do. The Ruth Institute has a dream that every child be welcomed into a loving home with a married mother and father. Presumably, that's everybody's dream here, right? That every child be welcomed into a loving home with a marriage, with a married mother and father, so that every child can have a relationship with both of their parents, unless some unavoidable tragedy prevents it, and so that every adult, without exception, can know who they are. So even if something happened in your life that you can't live with your natural mother and father, you still deserve to know who you are, and you deserve to be connected to your cultural heritage and your genetic heritage. We don't need to be going around having the government have a policy of falsifying birth certificates so that people can't know who they are, all right? Now, when I talk like this, a lot of times people will say to me, Dr. Morse, you're forgetting about adoption. Now, that's not bloody likely, because if you look at my biography, you know, you will see that I'm an adoptive parent. All right, I'm a parent of a birth child, an adopted child, I'm a godmother, and we had 8 foster children. Okay, and in fact, this is my adopted son. Say hi, Nick. Okay, okay, and so no, I did. I don't forget about adoption. But here's the thing: adoption is different from the kinds of separations we're talking about today. The reason children come in to adopt, become available for adoption, is because some tragic circumstances take in place so that their parents can't take care of them. That something tragic has happened. It's not the adoptive parent causing the thing to happen, right? It's something else has happened, all right? And so if you look at it that way, adoption exists to give children the parents they need. It does not exist to give adults the kids they happen to want. And that's the difference between adoption and what we're now talking about. So in our case, you know, I can tell you for sure, Nick is a great part of our life. We can't imagine what our life would be like without him. We love him. We're good parents to him. He fits into our family. We have a kind of a joke that we spliced a gene into him, which is the bad joke gene, so that he would fit into the family. You know, he's part of our family, and we were great parents to him. And by the way, he had a lot to deal with in his life. Because adopted him from Romania when he was 2.5 years old. And I think he's on his way to becoming a saint because he's had so much to deal with in his life. So you can go shake his hand later and you know that you're shaking the hand of a saint. But here's the point. For him, the best thing would have been if none of this had ever happened to him, right? The best thing for him would have been if he could have lived with his mom and dad, you know? And it's unimaginable now, but that we would never have known him, you know, because we can't really imagine that because he's so much a part of our lives. But truly, I think most adoptive parents will tell you that they wish their child's mom and dad could have been there for whatever the problem was, whatever the issue was. And that's the difference between what we're talking about here and what's going on around us today. So that every parent will have the opportunity to exercise both their rights and responsibilities with respect to their children. So I want to just briefly tell you about the post-Obergefell situation in the United States. Obergefell is the name of our court case. It's the Roe versus Wade equivalent for the marriage issue. Okay, the logical consequence of what is happening, and a lot of times people ask me, what is the end game? What do these people want? A lot of them haven't thought through the whole thing all the way to the end, but some of the theorists have thought it through. And the logical end game, the logical conclusion of what they're talking about, is some combination of contract parenting and the welfare state to be the way that people take care of children. And ultimately the abolition of marriage itself. That's what they're really about. Okay. And contract parenting, I know that sounds freaky and weird and you can't figure out what it even means, but trust me, they're working on it. And it will, and I'll say a little bit more about it as we go along. So you can ask your friends. Now, throughout this talk, I'm going to emphasize things that you can say to your friends as you're going around talking about this issue, because trust me, you need to be out there talking to everybody you know about this, all right? And a lot of times, it's more effective not to talk to them, but to ask them a question. So I'll give you some questions that you can ask them, right? Because a lot of times if you sit there and sometimes people will say to me, Dr. Morse, what do I say when, right? And I'll be like, calm down. First off, calm down. But more importantly, if you start giving a speech, like what I'm giving you a speech tonight here, the other person's going to, you know, nod off halfway through your engagement with them. And of course, you don't want that. So ask them this question. Do you think that redefining marriage is the last thing you're going to be asked to accept? Do you think that once we've redefined marriage, all these people are going to go home and they're going to be satisfied and they're never going to ask you for anything else? They're never going to have, there's going to be no next step after that? And of course, the answer to that is no. They are going to be wanting other kinds of things. And so I put up here a quotation from an article in the Los Angeles Times. This article, I want you to notice the date. The article appeared on June 29th, 2015. That is Monday morning. The Supreme Court made its ruling on Friday, the 26th. On Monday morning, in the Los Angeles Times, we have this statement from a LGBT activist. Marriage equality doesn't immediately or necessarily erase cultural and legal attachments to biological dual gender parenting. Do you know what that means? What he's saying is, in plain English, he's saying now that we have marriage equality, we need to have parenting equality, which means we need to have surrogacy equality, which means we need to make it as easy as possible for people to reproduce artificially. And we need to get over our hang-ups about people being attached to their biological origins. 3 days after the ruling, that's what this guy comes out with, okay? So no, this is not the last thing you're going to be asked for, right? And this is what my earlier slides are dealing with, are trying to address and argue against. So the other thing that I'm going to recommend for you is that you talk about people who have been harmed by earlier phases of the sexual revolution, people who have been harmed or who are likely to be harmed by going forward with the redefinition of marriage and all the related issues. If you think about the people who are being victimized, the people who are being harmed, it's very important that it not appear that we're just talking about ourselves. Okay? As much as I love your Archbishop, and I would like to say it's not a good thing that he got this harassment case, you know, happening to him. The plain sad fact is many of our unchurched neighbors, many of our agnostic neighbors, do not give a rip if a Catholic archbishop is inconvenienced in his life, or if you are inconvenienced in your worship. They couldn't give a rip. I'm sorry, but that's where we are, all right? So let's think about other people who have been hurt besides us, All right? You see what I mean? All right? Because it sounds like we're whining about ourselves, and we don't want to do that, right? I mean, it's not fair what they're doing to us. It's obviously not fair, but there are other people we can talk about. So let's look at this, just a few things that will follow directly from the redefinition of marriage and that are already in place, are already in motion. And the transgender bathroom laws are a big thing happening in the United States. I presume you heard about this. Just since I've been on this trip, President Obama has laid down an edict that every public school in America is to have transgender open bathroom policies. You guys are looking at me like this is the craziest thing ever, and you are right. It is a very crazy thing, but this is where they're going. And he's using the full force of the federal government to make this happen. Now, who is being harmed by this? The little girls. The little school children who do not want to be in a bathroom with somebody of the opposite gender pulling down their pants, you know, or showering. You know, they just don't want to be there. So here is a truly vulnerable party that we can talk about. The sexual education in the schools is becoming much more aggressive, much more aggressively promoting homosexuality is normal, and homosexuality is good. Homosexuality as superior to heterosexuality, okay? And then, of course, in all cases, in all times, crushing dissent, all different kinds of dissenters. So what we want to keep our eyes on the prize here, I call this keeping our eyes on the prize. We want to realize that justice to children, family structure equality, family structure justice, that is what we want to keep our eyes on. That the rights of parents and children to know one another, that's the ultimate goal. And religious liberty and all these other things that American conservatives like to talk about are really, in a way, secondary. What I want to say, too abstract. They're too abstract. We a lot of our people like to talk about judicial tyranny and these kind of things. And we in the U.S. have spent way too much time on that stuff, and it's not helping. So the family, as I say, the family is unique. There are some people who want to replace the family with contracts. There are other people who want to replace the family with the welfare state. Neither of those strategies is really going to work because the family is a human institution. It's a divinely ordained institution, but it makes us human, and it can't be replaced by contracts and government or any of those type of things. I laid out these kinds of arguments 15 years ago in a book called Love and Economics, and that's still the seminal work that I go with. So what we're dealing with is two competing worldviews here. I think all of us believe, that every child, and hence every adult, has identity rights and relational rights with respect to their parents. And, here's the part we don't like to say too loudly, and these rights impose obligations on the adults. Right, we don't like to say that because people don't like obligations, all right? The alternative competing worldview is adults are entitled to the sexual activity they want with a minimum of inconvenience, and kids just have to accept whatever the adults want to give them. We don't like to say that too loud because we'd be ashamed of ourselves if we just blurted it out like that. But that's approximately where we are and where we've been for about 50 years, really my whole lifetime, starting with no-fault divorce. So here are the three big topics that I'm going to cover with you tonight. I'm going to first of all explain to you what the sexual revolution is, how I define it, how I understand it, then how this marriage issue fits in with this overall picture of the sexual revolution, and then how can you learn from our mistakes in the United States so you don't have to reinvent the wheel with a lot of the things that we have had to do. Now let me just ask a question, if you don't mind my asking this. We're in a Catholic church, we're in the Catholic Cathedral. How many are practicing Catholics? Do we have any separated brothers and sisters here? Good, good. Well, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad y'all are here. I'm really glad. Glad y'all are here. Welcome. So I don't want to freak you out by assuming everybody's Catholic, but for these purposes, I think we're all Catholics now, in a certain way. Okay. So what is the sexual revolution? I define the sexual revolution as having three main points. Okay. The first main point of sexual revolution is that sex and childbearing can be and should be separated from one another. A good and decent society will separate sex from childbearing. Okay? The second point of the sexual revolution is that a good and decent society will separate sex and procreation from marriage. So you can have sex without having a baby, you can have sex without being married, you can have a baby without being married, you can be married without having sex, you can be married without having any babies. These are all completely separated from one another, all right? You recognize this? Right, yeah, sure, we all recognize this. No, you know, some of us my age sort of might remember that we thought it was going to be a lot of fun to have sex without having babies. That was the good part, right? Now we're to the point where we're having babies without having sex, which I'm pretty sure is not as much fun as the old-fashioned way, right? But that's where we are. That's where our society is. Okay, then finally, the third point of the sexual revolution is that men and women are really completely interchangeable. Actually, we've kind of moved beyond even this point. Male and female is completely constructed. And it used to be that it was all socially constructed, but now we can personally reconstruct it. We can make ourselves into a man or to a woman or whatever we want to be, okay? And I put this image up here for you because I got this image from the Boston Globe, a story that they did some years ago. And the theme was how wonderful it was going to be when children could have more than two parents, okay? And so these little clusters of adults over here are supposed to represent all the different parents that this one child has. Okay, but I don't want to go into that right now, as weird as that is. I don't want to go into that. The thing I want you to notice is this drawing of the child, you cannot tell if this is a boy or a girl. Okay, the Boston Globe created that image for a reason, right? They're normalizing the idea that you cannot tell whether this is a boy or a girl, all right? So I didn't draw that cartoon. Somebody else drew that. And this is part of where our society is headed. So now I want to give you some examples, another example of somebody victimized by the gender ideology. Point three, by the way, point three there. This thing that I'm just describing, this is what Pope Francis is talking about when he talks about gender ideology, and he has condemned gender ideology in no uncertain terms on multiple occasions, okay? This is the kind of thing that he's talking about, and he talks about it being cultural imperialism of the first world against the third world, all right? And believe me, that's how they feel about it, too. They don't want any part of, a lot of this stuff. Anyhow, I want to, on your handout that I gave you, this handout, I put this together as a fact sheet. I'm doing lots of talks here. So this is just a variety of material that I want you to have at your fingertips that you can take with you. But on one of the pages, there is, I think it's the very last page. On the very last page, I give a reference to an article that talks about the gender ideology. And so you can go look this article up. It's called Euthanizing the Unhappy. Okay, and this is an article I wrote a few years ago. And this woman, I want to say, is a victim of the gender ideology. And here's what happened to her. The headlines said, Belgian killed by euthanasia after botched sex change operation. So I'm thinking, this is an interesting thing. I read the story. When you read the story, what you find out is that there was nothing wrong with the sex change operation. There's no allegation that the doctors did anything wrong, no malpractice, anything like that. It's just that the woman was dissatisfied with how she looked. She looked at herself, she didn't like the way her body looked, she didn't like the way her chest looked, and so on. She was dissatisfied with how she looked. And so after that, she asked to be euthanized. And so this headline is misleading on multiple levels. They're following the guidelines of using a gender-neutral description of this person, because this is a transgender person, so they don't say a Belgian man or a Belgian woman, they say just a Belgian. Well, who the heck What? There's no such thing as a gender-neutral person. And then what they do is say, Nathan born Nancy Verhelst. That's how they describe her. But then you read further into the story, and you find, why did she want to be to change her gender? Why did she want that? Did she feel that she was a man trapped in a woman's body? This is what we hear, right? That people are men trapped in woman's body, woman trapped in a man's body. Is that her situation? Is that how she felt? Is that what she wanted? No. When you read the story, what you find out is her mother wanted a son. Her mother rejected her because she was a girl. Literally rejected her because she was a girl. It was unbelievable how callous her mother was. And so Nancy decided that she would change her gender. And of course that didn't work. Of course that didn't help the underlying problem of having an unbelievably callous mother. Now what I want to say to you is, what were the doctors thinking that they could not figure out that this woman did not need a sex change operation? She needed love. That's what she needed, was love. And they did this, and then they euthanized her because she asked for it. It's unbelievable. This woman is a victim of the gender ideology. And there will be other victims of the gender ideology. They're happening right now. There are people in the United States who believe their children are transgender children. They're giving them hormone blockers to prevent puberty from happening. It's unbelievable what some of those kids are going to feel when they grow up. There are people being harmed by this. All right, so the sexual revolution here, if you take nothing else away from this talk, this is the main thing I want you to get, and you can write this down now if you want to. The sexual revolution is an irrational ideology. They are trying to create a fantasy ideology. Now, why do I say that? Well, go back to those 3 points. We're going to separate sex from childbearing. Guess what? Sex actually makes babies. We're all on board with that? Okay, that's not a theological deal. Okay, so we're all on board with that. Sex actually makes babies. Kids actually do need their mothers and fathers. That's why we have marriage. And men and women really are different. All right? So what they're trying to do is to create a world around 3 things that are false. And it cannot be done. It cannot be done. You cannot create a world where sex doesn't make babies. It can't be done. Right? So therefore, it is a totalitarian ideology. You need to see that this is a totalitarian ideology. What happened to your archbishop is not an accident. It's not a fluke. It's the way the thing is structured. Because when you have something built on unreality, it cannot stand on its own. Mom and dad having sex and having babies and taking care of the babies, that's natural and supports itself. It reinforces itself. But something that is irrational cannot stand on its own. It has to be propped up all the time. So it has to be propped up with force, and it has to be propped up with propaganda. All right? So you guys, if you feel like you're ever pressed down and oppressed with propaganda, that there's just one more TV show, one more advertisement, one more executive order from the president, you know, whatever it is, you feel like you're being oppressed, you are. And we have never understood the sexual revolution for the pagan totalitarian ideology that it is. And that's why we're 50 years behind, right? It doesn't fit with left and right exactly. It doesn't exactly fit left and right. And a lot of you know that from experience, okay? So that's why we should not cooperate with it. We should not compromise with it. It is a pagan ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with, okay? And, you know, we didn't get it. We just didn't get it. All right, so unfortunately, the sexual revolution has been with us for quite a while. My latest book is called The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims, and we put on the cover Marilyn Monroe. Now, why would we put Marilyn Monroe on the cover? Because she's a symbol of the sexual revolution and its victims. She was victimized by the sexual revolution, even while she's still a symbol of glamour. Right? You can still see people wearing her on a t-shirt and carrying tote bags and so on and so forth. But they don't usually mention that she had 12 abortions. Those images don't show the bottle of pills land beside her. you know, and the fact that she died at the age of 39. You know, none of that, that's all airbrushed away, all right? Now, the thing, reason that's so important is because that's the whole pattern of the sexual revolution, is we're given this image that this is this great march to freedom and equality and glory and fun, right? But you never see the downside. The downside is always airbrushed out of the picture, just like Marilyn Monroe's life, okay? So that's why we want to be focused on people who are being harmed and why we want to begin giving voice to those victims. Very important part of our strategy. So now, how does the marriage issue, part two here, how does the marriage issue fit into this overall picture of the sexual revolution? Well, first of all, you may have noticed, and I have actually written down on here, I never use the term gay marriage, and I suggest that you not use the term gay marriage. Why? Our position is there's no such thing as a gay marriage. Just because you can imagine a gay marriage doesn't mean there really is a gay marriage. You can imagine a pink unicorn. That doesn't mean there are pink unicorns, okay? Every time you use the term gay marriage or same-sex marriage or anything like that, you're carrying water for the other side. You're making their fantasy ideology look plausible. You don't need to do that. They get plenty of time at the mic. So you use some other term. I like to talk about the redefinition of marriage. We're redefining marriage. That's what we're doing. I like to talk about genderless marriage, or we're removing the gender requirement from marriage. Okay? There are a number of different things you can say, and I put them on your handout, but I want to emphasize to you, you got to do this. Okay? You got to practice getting that out of your system, you know, to not use that term. And by the way, it's perfectly okay for you to use a big, long, clunky phrase rather than their simple cliche phrase, okay? Because when you use a big, long, clunky phrase, you're forcing people to think about what you're actually saying. What we're really talking about here is changing the law so that wherever it says union of a man and a woman, we're going to say now the union of any two persons. That's what we're talking about. Well, you know, I've talked to activists, marriage activists on the other side who never thought about the fact that that's what the law would look like when they were done, right? The union of any two persons. Anyway, but feel free to take a long sentence to describe what is really going on here. So, removing the gender requirement from marriage, that's what we're going to talk about. So, there are three things you have to believe in order to support the redefinition of marriage. First of all, you have to believe that marriage is fundamentally about adults and not children. Marriage is fundamentally about adults and what they want, not about kids and what they need. That's what you have to believe to start with, okay? And does our culture already believe that? Yes, our culture already believes that. Unilateral divorce, no-fault divorce, we already believe that it's about us getting to do what we want and the kids just have to come along later and accept whatever we give them. Do we already believe that sex is fundamentally a sterile activity? Well, yes, we do. Okay, that's why we promote, the government promotes contraception. The government promotes abortion. You know, it was never enough. Are you in America, we're big on this freedom thing, right? So it's like we have to let people do whatever they want. You know what? That was never enough for the true sexual revolutionary. When we removed all the laws about contraception from our books with one Supreme Court decision in 1965, no state can regulate or forbid people to use contraception in any way. That was never enough for the true radicals. They had to go and take the next step of actively promoting it through the government. The government actively promotes contraception and abortion. So just letting it sit out there on the shelf and people can take it or leave it as they choose. No, that was not what these people want. And that's still not what these people want. They want to create a world where sex is usually a sterile activity with procreation thrown in as an afterthought if you happen to like that sort of thing. If you have quirky lifestyle preferences, you can have a baby if you feel like it. Okay, then the third thing you have to believe in order to support the redefinition of marriage is that men and women are completely interchangeable. That if you have two moms, two dads, mom and a dad, doesn't matter, it's all the same. Okay, so here's what we're dealing with as a culture, here's what you guys are dealing with when you go forward to debate and argue in favor of man-woman marriage. We already believe these things in the culture. If you believe that sex doesn't matter, if you believe the body doesn't matter, if you believe that marriage doesn't really matter, then why not let gay people get married? You know, you're just being mean to us by not letting us be part of your thing, your club. You see what I mean? So we've already accepted the things that make it seem plausible. And that's the sense in which we're way behind. So anyway, let me now give you a little thought experiment to help you see what marriage really is. Okay, so we're walking around already with a fake, messed up view of marriage. All right, so what is it really all about? Let me introduce you to these three people here. You can tell it's mother, father, and a baby. It looks like, you know, they got those genetically engineered sunglasses, so that's how you know they're related to each other, you know. What does society owe these people? What does society owe these three people, mother, father, and baby? Now, Labor versus Liberal Party might argue about whether we owe them health care or daycare or anything like that, you know. But I want to suggest there's something much more fundamental that society owes these three people. Society owes it to them to say that these two people are the parents of that child and no one else is. No one else has parental rights over that child. It's their child, coming from the union of their two bodies, all right? So grandma doesn't get parental rights. In some of our subcultures in America, that's not clear, right? Grandma's, you know, kind of right in there. Not legally, but, you know, in fact, she's right in there. Your next door neighbor who happens to have a doctorate in child development does not get parental rights, right? And your former boyfriend doesn't get parental rights, or your new boyfriend doesn't get parental rights, all right? And that is very much at stake in the redefinition of marriage. So the essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their parent, to their children and to one another. This is the essential public purpose of marriage. Now, it's essential in the sense that if you didn't need to get this done, nobody would have ever thought of marriage, right? This is why you have marriage, okay? And it's a public purpose as opposed to all the private purposes or the private reasons that people might have for getting married. Most of the time when people talk to you about why they want to get married, they're telling you their private reasons. So you want to have a big party. You want to feel like you're part of, you know, one of the group. You want to get your parents off of your back. When are you going to get married? You know, or you want to irritate your previous boyfriend. Whatever reason you might have for wanting to get married, those are private purposes. Those are private reasons, and they don't add up to a public reason as to why you have the law involved in the first place. But you see, if your purpose really is to attach mothers and fathers to children and to one another, that is a public purpose because it's the law that's going to keep all those other people away who might show up and say, I have some claim here, right? It's the law that has to do that. And so if that is your understanding of why you have marriage at all, then you can see immediately that same-sex couples and opposite-sex couples are different with respect to that purpose. Can you all see that? Has to do with biology. Do I need to go into it? Okay, it's all good. But you know what? I think I will go into it in a minute. Never you mind. Anyway, the point is, under American discrimination law, and this is a way in which the American dog is wagging its tail and affecting everybody. Under American discrimination law, if two groups of people are different with respect to some important purpose of the law, it's perfectly okay to treat them differently. It's not discrimination to treat different things differently, right, if they're different with respect to the essential purpose. And so for gay marriage to make its inroads into American law, what they had to do was to redefine that purpose. They had to change the purpose of marriage. Because if you believe that that's the purpose, then it's over. It's over. Man-woman marriage is a perfectly acceptable governmental arrangement. So let's talk about. Let me go to Judge Walker here. First of all, got slides slightly shuffled. Okay, the courts, our courts understand that they need this kind of purpose, that they need to redefine the purpose. This is a picture of Judge Vaughn Walker, who was the judge who overturned Proposition 8 in California. Now, I'm very sensitive about this because I lived in California at that time, and I was actually a campaign spokeswoman for Proposition 8. And we worked very hard on that campaign. And by the way, let me just remind you of something. We won. We won. Okay. If California can vote for man-woman marriage, Australia can vote for man-woman marriage. Got it? Okay. Just reminding you. We won this campaign. Anyway, this is a guy who overturned it. And here's what he said in his 200-page ruling. He said, the purpose of marriage is this. Marriage is the state recognition and approval of a couple's choice to live with each other, to remain committed to one another, and to form a household based on their own feelings about one another, and to join in an economic partnership and to support any dependence. You know, this could be roommates, right? There's nothing in there about children. There's nothing even in there about sex. This doesn't have to be a sexual relationship. You see that? They don't have to consummate this relationship. They just have to share a little money, right? So you got to... Why did he need to do that? Because he needed to take the procreative purpose out of marriage, because if procreative purpose is even one of the purposes, that's no good. So that gets buried. It has to be buried. It's not just that it's moved down the list, it's off the list. That's what he's doing there, okay? And that's what they'll do to you too. They'll redefine the public meaning of marriage. So I want to talk to you just about how redefining marriage redefines parenthood. And this is another story that's on your handout that you can go read the whole story later on if you want to. This is a case of a little girl named MC. We don't know her name. We just know her initials from court documents. This little girl was born in March of 2009. Her mother and father had a normal sexual relationship. Well, I suppose you could call it normal, but they were not married, but they had a sexual relationship. Her mother then married another woman, okay? And this is during the window of time that same-sex couples were allowed to get married. So her mother and father had sex. The little girl was conceived. Dad disappears. Mom's named Melissa. She marries a woman named Irene. The two of them are married. Little girl is born in March. And after about 3 weeks, the relationship breaks up. Melissa takes her little girl and moves out. Irene then starts court proceedings to get partial custody, to get shared custody of the child because she was married to them. She was married to the child's mother. Now, you have to understand, how do we determine who is the child's mother or father? How do we determine this? You all are British. You guys have British law. You do it the same way we do. Actually, all civilized countries do something roughly like this. The child's mother. Who is the child's mother? The person who gives birth to the baby. We all on board with that? That's good. That's very good. I'm glad. Now, we actually are having a little problem with that in the U.S. over surrogacy. See, if you got a surrogate mother, the woman who gives birth to the baby isn't legally the mother. And thank God your country has rejected commercial surrogacy just recently. Isn't that so? Did I get that right? I'm very grateful that you guys did that. But anyway, that's still... So putting surrogacy aside, the person who gives birth to the baby is the mother of the child under the law. Okay, but now the question is, who's the daddy? The daddy can be anywhere. The daddy can be anybody, right? So the law presumes that the woman's husband is the child's father. That's the presumption of paternity. It's an ancient presumption. As soon as people could figure out that people got pregnant by something other than the river god impregnating them or something, you know, people figured out that this is who the other parent is. So the law is the child's other parent, the child's father, is presumed to be the woman's husband. So what happened with the case of little MC? Well, wait, before I get to that, back to Melissa and Irene. Because Irene initiated court proceedings to try to get shared custody of the child, Melissa got angry, and she got her new boyfriend, Jose. Melissa and Jose stalked Irene, beat her up, knifed her so badly that she had to be hospitalized. And then, of course, Melissa was put in jail, where she belongs, after all of that. Melissa and Jose both go to jail. And so Child Protective Services moves in to take custody of this little girl, little MC, because one person's in the hospital, one person's in jail. So somebody has to take care of the little baby. So they take her into custody, and now the biological father reappears on the scene. He finds out what's going on. He had moved away to Oklahoma. He comes back to California and says, I'd like to have custody of my little girl. Turns out the little girl's father was named Jesus. It looks like Jesus. We have a lot of Mexican people who are named Jesus, but it's pronounced Jesus. Anyway, hey, it's kind of cool, actually, because the only good guy in this whole story is Jesus. So that's cool. That's cool. So Jesus comes back and says, I'd like to take custody of my daughter. I don't want her to be in foster care. And the court said, gee whiz, you know, I don't, Melissa's the child's mother because she gave birth to the child. And Irene, you know, we have to do a gender neutral reading of the Uniform Parentage Act. And so Irene is presumed to be the child's other parent because we can't, it's gender neutral. I guess you're the biological father and you seem to be perfectly fit. But, you know, under California law, a child can only have two parents. So, sorry, you're out of luck. And so the little girl stayed in foster care for almost 18 months before they got that sorted out. Now, most people would think that this was an argument to not have genderless marriage and to not be trying to do a gender-neutral reading of the Parenting Act, right? I mean, most normal people would think that, right? But not in California. In California, they concluded, we need a three-parent law. We need a three-parent law. And so it's now possible in California for a child to have three legal parents. This is what is coming if you guys lose. Okay, I'm just saying. This is how marriage gets how redefining marriage redefines parenthood. And you can read all about it in the reference that I gave you. Okay, so let me move on then to more examples of victims. And Nick, if you would you pass out these children and same-sex parenting brochures? You start at that end, honey. You go that way, and I'll go this way. Just get these going around. So you've probably heard that the kids will be all right. All right, I just want to point out a couple of things about the kids being all right. The claim that we have all these studies, and all these studies show that the kids are fine with genderless parenting, okay? We put together this brochure. I put together this brochure that is called Children and Same-Sex Parenting. And on the inside, it goes through some of the things that kids are particularly at risk for if their moms or dads are involved in a same-sex relationship, okay? And I also in there go through some of the problems with some of the other studies that have been done. So that's, again, this is something I want you to walk away with, or I won't go through all of it. But I want to just point out a couple of things about this whole area, okay? When we changed the law to allow no-fault divorce, everybody said the following kinds of things. They said, we have studies showing that the kids will be fine as long as their parents are happy. Have you ever heard that? Kids will be fine as long as their parents are happy. Do we now believe that to be true? We now know that that's completely rubbish, right? We know that's complete nonsense. But we were assured that it would all be fine. So now we're in a situation where we're going forward to the next step of saying, you can have genderless parenting and the kids will be fine. We've got studies that say the kids will be fine. All right. So that's another point that you can kind of keep in mind. Now, also, people are not necessarily born that way. And again, this is something that is in your handout. But there's the American Psychological Association made a statement saying, we don't really know why some people are born gay and some people aren't. We really don't know. Maybe there's a genetic factor. Maybe there's environmental factors. They never want to talk about how people are brought up as a factor. They never want to talk about that. That kind of study has been politically incorrect for probably 30 or 40 years. And that the theory that your upbringing had something to do with your gayness, that theory was never disproven. It was basically just shouted down. Okay, so there's that point that we don't really know why some people are and some people aren't. But then also, if you look in your handout, there's a chart on there on page 2. It's on page 2, and it's a chart showing just a correlation now, no claim about causality, but just a correlation between people who are opposite sex attracted, that's OSA, and people who are same sex attracted, that's SSA. And whether you've been abused in any way, whether you experienced child abuse as a child. And what you'll see on there is that that men who are same-sex attracted, about 15% of them supposedly were sexually abused, whereas opposite-sex attracted men is much, much, much lower. It's like, what, 6 or 7 times difference, okay? And I gave this talk yesterday in St. Mary's. And the Mother of God is following me around on this trip. It's really cool. But up at St. Mary's, I pointed this out. And a man who was himself an ex-gay, somebody who's had recovered from the whole gay lifestyle, he raised his hand and he said, that in my experience, probably 75% of gay men had experienced child abuse at some point, had been sexually assaulted. Now, here's the thing. Here's the way in which our ideology is victimizing people. If you're a person who was sexually abused as a child and that might have had something to do with your same-sex attraction, which seems plausible, it's possible, right? It's not completely out of the question. But we're all walking around with this ideology that says everybody's born that way. That means that person can't get help. They cannot get meaningful help. They cannot get meaningful therapy for that connection between their fixation on a person of the same sex as opposed to a person of the opposite sex, the connection between that and whatever it was that they experienced in their childhood. In the United States, it's gotten to the point where it is illegal to treat people for unwanted same-sex attraction. So-called reparative therapy is now illegal to do on children. Okay, so if a client comes into a therapist's office and says, I want help because I don't like being same-sex attracted. I want help. People are afraid to take them as clients because they're afraid that they're going to be set up and sued and so on and so forth. So what I think you need to do is help your friends and neighbors see that there is a downside to accepting this ideology. It's not all just compassion for this poor guy who was born that way. Maybe he was born that way, maybe he wasn't born that way, right? Maybe there's something else going on. We aren't even letting ourselves look at that. And my friend who talked to me yesterday basically said, that's the number one thing that gay men want to talk about in their support groups. If they're in any kind of supportive environment, they want to talk about the connection between the childhood sexual abuse that they experienced and what's going on with them in their life right now. So here's another thing that you can ask your friends and your neighbors if you get into one of these discussions with them. You can ask them, why is marriage equality for adults so much more compelling a state interest, so much more important than family structure equality for children? Why don't we want equality for children? Why do we only want equality for adults? Okay? Ask them that and get that conversation going. Why is compassion for the person who is born that way more significant than the compassion for the person who may have unwanted same-sex attraction connected to something that traumatic that happened to them? Why are we not addressing that? Okay, so those are other questions that you can ask. All right, so what can you learn from our mistakes in the United States? Well, I've been kind of sneaking those all in here as we're going along, but let me spell it out for you. Just spell out what we did. Okay, I believe in general, our focus was way too narrow. The way the sexual revolution proceeds is they say, All we want is just this one little thing. All we want is for two people who love each other to be able to get married. All we want is for people to be allowed to have abortions in case of rape or incest. All we want is for people, married couples with serious health issue, to be allowed to use contraception. That's all we really want. That's not all they really want. Okay, so it's better if you keep the issue broad rather than narrow, because they'll want to narrow it down. So the point is that you don't want to play on their turf. You want to expand the turf so that you're dealing with an issue that you can deal with. I think that we did not spend enough time talking about the sexual revolution overall. And here's what would happen. Those very first slides that I would have put up there, if you start talking about how kids are entitled to relationship with both parents, very first thing that's going to happen is somebody's going to say, well, what about divorce? And a lot of our politicians over there would just run for the hills as soon as you mention divorce, because they've all been through two or three marriages or whatever, okay? So we have to be fearless about that and say, well, you know what? That was a structural injustice to the child as well. That's a structural injustice. That's how we know this is going to end badly. Everything bad that happens to kids from divorce, all that's going to happen to the kids in same-sex parenting households, and then some. By the way, that little chart I gave you, if I could just show you this chart, this one right here. I'm very proud of this chart. Okay, this chart right here, all these things that happen to kids who are same-sex attracted, or whose parents were in a same-sex relationship, these are things which happen in a more pronounced manner than simply what happens to kids of divorce. So, in other words, children whose parents are divorced have these things happen to them. Kids whose parents are in a same-sex union have these things happen even more pronounced. Those are the only things I put on this list. So if you think about it, if you think about all the problems that children have when their parents are divorced and remarried, you think about all of that, that's going to be part of the experience of the typical child in a same-sex parenting household. They're going to have a lot of those same issues, and some of them they're going to have even worse. Okay, so that's why you can't freak out and be scared if somebody says, what about divorce? You know, you have to be ready to deal with that. Okay, and we also we're still talking way too much about religious liberty and freedom of speech, and not nearly enough about how people are being harmed by the sexual revolution. And the overarching mistake that I want to point out to you is that we had the idea that if we just got the arguments right, everything would be okay. This is kind of a sin of intellectuals. You know, intellectuals think if we could just figure it out and get the arguments right, people will see reason and it will all be good. Well, that's actually not true. This was a big blow to me. You know, because I really like getting arguments right and stuff, and I like debating. And I finally realized I have won a lot of debates, and yet we're losing. So how is that working, right? The reason that's happening is because the other side has all these emotional arguments that have to do with people being harmed, okay? And that's why you've got to respond with the other people who are being harmed, the people who are nameless, faceless, without a voice, okay? That's what you've got to do in order to win this thing. And if you start thinking in Catholic natural law terms, you will see... This is how we think, you guys. You will see that what happens is that sin is not cost-effective. That's my economics training coming out. Okay, sin does not work. Sin hurts you. God is trying to keep us out of trouble when he gives us these rules. He's not just trying to hurt us and spoil our fun, right? He's trying to keep us out of trouble. And so, therefore, if you think like that, then you'll start looking for, okay, who got hurt? Who got hurt? Let's not be diverted by all of the smokescreen that's being thrown in our eyes, okay? Now, I don't think you should give up on politics in the courts here in Australia, because you need to fight this to win this. In the United States, we almost have to give up on the courts because it's hopeless. But our situation is possibly unique. But I think you guys can win this, and I think you really need to win this. I want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about healing the culture in a lasting and Christ-like manner. And Nick, would you pass out this one last piece of paper that I want you guys to have? And I'll tell you about it in just a moment. You know, if it's not Christ-like, If it's not a Christ-like solution, I don't want anything to do with it. Right? Right? If it's not Christ-like, it's not going to last anyway. All right? So we have to look for Christ-like solutions to this dilemma in which we find ourselves. And one of the things that brought this to my mind was this great movie about Carol Wojtyla. And this statement was attributed to him. See, this is one of our favorite cool pictures of Pope John Paul when he was a young man, when he was looking really hip, you know. There's a scene in the movie where the statement is attributed to John Paul when he's a young man in the seminary. And it's during the Nazi occupation, right? And he says, if we don't, and people are trying to figure out, well, do we resist with guns, or do we fight, or what do we do when we're under Nazi occupation? And he comes to the conclusion, if we don't win through love, the evil will just come in another form. And indeed, the evil did come in another form, right? They were occupied then by communism, right? So somehow, we need to find Christ-like solutions to the things that we're dealing with. And that's what we're trying to do at the Ruth Institute. So the way we look at it is there's victims everywhere, and never a soul to speak. Never anybody to say, yes, some of you recognize the... that couplet. Very good. Well-educated people. So if you think about the people who have been harmed over the years by the sexual revolution, what we want to do is to give those people a voice. We want to give them an opportunity to speak out and to say what has happened to them. So this new brochure that I just handed you, I think I gave out my last one, so let me hold it up for you. This is called Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? Do you know a survivor of the sexual revolution? Everybody knows a survivor of the sexual revolution. Everybody knows somebody who's been through this, okay? You open it up and you look down the list here. There are all these different people who have in some way or another been harmed. So we have, at the top of the list, child of divorce. If we look down further, we have the heartbroken career woman. That's the person who gave up everything for her career and then found out she couldn't have kids when she's 40. And then we have the pornography addict and the post-abortive woman. And we have the refugees from the hookup culture. A lot of us got into that, right? And you'll see gay lifestyle refugees. They're just on the list. They're just one more guys on the list. They're not the center of attention here, right? It's not all about them. We don't want them to think we're singling them out. See, in America, I think a lot of times people got the idea, you know, we're perfectly fine with the sexual revolution. We just don't like the gay parts. You know, that won't do. That won't do. We're not fine with the sexual revolution, and we have to take responsibility for any way that we might have participated in it. So here's the list of people, and over here are the lies they were told. The very top of the list, the very first big lie of the sexual revolution, kids are resilient. You know, and then all of these lies, just lies. The whole culture is just filled with this stuff. People are driving down the wrong side of the road in the fog. You know, people don't know what's going on. So a lot of us have been victimized by the cultural confusion that's out there. And so the basic strategy that we are proposing is to identify victims, help people to see that, yes, you've been lied to, yes, you've been harmed, and then get people to start talking about that in an honest way so that we're not all rediscovering the wheel for the first time, like we're the first person that ever had this happen to us. And so what we're proposing is the concept of healing friendship. Healing friendship, that is that you reach out to people that you know who are suffering and that you walk alongside them with whatever is going on in their lives. And in some cases, I bet you a lot of you have relatives who've left the church, kids who've left the church, people are off the reservation. Pretty much every family has somebody who's like that. And so you got to be in there for the long haul with them. And this is what we're trying to develop training programs to help people know how to do this. So right now, I'm just putting this out there for you as an understanding of how to do that. Now, I put these two ladies up here in the garden club here because I have a friend in the United States who is now a very on fire Catholic. And the reason she's a very on fire Catholic, she was kind of a, you know, lackadaisical nominal Catholic. Do you have those in Australia? Oh, that's like yes. Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, that was a laugh line. Good. So her mom was a, you know, kind of a nominal Catholic, but her mom was in the garden club for a number of years with a lady who was a very on fire Catholic. And over the period of years, her mom got on fire because of the lady in the garden club. And then the daughter got on fire because of her mom, who got on fire because of the lady in the garden club. And now the daughter is one of the attorneys defending one of those bakers who's in trouble for not baking the gay wedding cake. Okay? So the point is, that lady in the garden club had no idea of the full impact of her friendship on that on the environment there in Colorado, you know. So never underestimate the importance of what you can do. And so I think some of you guys are going to be really good at this, right? You don't have to have a PhD to do it. You don't have to be a public speaker to do it. Every person has friends. And you can do this. You guys can do this. Now, another thing you can do is you can go to the Ruth Institute website. We have a spot on our website called Tell Ruth the Truth. And that's where people are writing their stories. They submit it. And we've got children of divorce. We've got refugees from the hookup culture. We've got all kind of people starting to tell their story. It's very helpful. It's very healing for people. Okay? So I want to close now with the concept of what we're going to do together. What are we going to do together? What future are we going to build together? And this is an image of the evacuation from Dunkirk in June of 1940. This is a very dark time in our in the history of the world. And in some respects, we're in a very dark time in a spiritual sense. We're in a spiritual war here. And so who is the guy who came forward after that? It was Winston Churchill, okay? And after the evacuation at Dunkirk, he gave one of the most stirring speeches to rally the British public. And you guys are probably more connected to this than I am as a Yank. You know, you probably know all of this very well. But of course, 4 years later, they came back in D-Day, and they won, and they did it. They did what they set out to do. But here's what he said at that time, when everything seemed very dark. He said, "If we fail, then the whole world, including the United States," and he was trying to get us to join the war at that point still, "including the United States, all that we have known and cared for will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science." And that perverted science was eugenics that he was talking about, by the way. "Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duties and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth should last for 1,000 years, men will still say this was their finest hour." Now, my friends, we have it on good authority that the Catholic Church will last until the end of time. Whether that's 1,000 hours or 1,000 minutes or 1,000 years. You like that? No offense, you guys. But outlasting oppressive governments since 33 AD. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Get into a land war with us, you guys. Yeah, come on, come on. That's like going to war with Russia. It looks like a good idea in June, but, you know, in October, not so much. Anyway, we have it on good authority that we're going to last. We don't know how. We don't know in what form. We don't know how long. But let this be our finest hour. Thank you very much.
You've just been listening to Dr. J's talk, "Same-Sex Marriage Affects Everyone," from Hobart Cathedral of St. Mary's in Tasmania, Australia. Check out our Ruth Refuge for the Q&A session afterward. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.